But there are a lot of differences between these compasses and these compasses, you know, and most people won't notice when they buy them on the internet, you know, and but once you've bought something, it's too late. You know, as an example, the Kamenga has an index line for reading the bearing, and also it's got a tritium mark for lining up the north arrow, and also, you know, when you're using it with a map. But this type of compass doesn't use either an index line or a tritium mark. So even though these may look similar, the way they're used is totally different. So let's get into this. How do we use this mixed up mess of a compass? I say it's a mixed up compass because even though it's a copy, cheap copy, of some of the very early versions of the M1950 compass, they were made by a company called Stocker and Yale in Massachusetts. It also has some parts taken from the very old sort of M1938. Look at that. Normally we get English history, today we're getting American history. The old M1938 compass, they were made by a company with a very strange name. What's it called? The Superior Magneto Corporation in New York. And those were the main compass that were used by the American military during the Second World War. In some ways, these are the same as any other lensatic compass. You know, you lift the lid, and the lid has got a wire in it, and then you line up the target through the notch so that the wire is placed on the target. You then look through the lens, and you can read the bearing on the rotating disc. But on these compasses, there are two yellow lines, and you can see them on early versions of the M1950 and also on the M1938. What do you think they're for, these two yellow lines? Okay, now I looked at the instructions earlier on my phone, and it says that the yellow lines on the sight glass are intended for fast walking under difficult conditions. So that's just wrong. That is not what the yellow lines are for. That's the company that actually makes these. Whatever. So what actually are these? So you'll see there's a long yellow line and there's a short yellow line. Now the long one, well, in the past that was used in the same way as the direction arrow on a base plate compass, you know, and the short line was used to give you a second reference when it was used at night. Now I know that sounds quite strange, and you know, bear with me and I'll go through it. But before you can use the two yellow lines, you have to know how to set your compass to a bearing. As I said, you know, to take a bearing from a ground feature, it's just like any other lensatic. You lift the lid up, hold the compass level, and then sight the feature through the lens and read the direction in the degrees on the rotating disc. So let's say we have a bearing of, I don't know, something like 1, 2, 3 degrees. Another way of getting a bearing is from a map. Now, the instructions which come with the compass will tell you to draw lines on the map and then rotate the map and the compass together so they're both pointing north and do other strange things. Just ignore all that. I'll tell you how to actually take a bearing from a map using this type of compass. Let's say that I'm here and I want to go here. So you put your compass on the map so the edge is touching your start point and your destination. The map can be pointing in any direction, it makes no difference to the outcome. Don't forget that just like with a Kamenga, the saying is that we walk the wire. This means that you go from the dial towards the wire. Okay, so make sure your compass is pointing in the right direction. All you do then is you rotate the glass until the long yellow line is pointing directly up the map, so it's pointing north. That's it. The long yellow line is pointing north. Then you pick up your compass and you turn it around until the north arrow on the disc is underneath the long yellow line. And the bearing number that you're going to follow is, you read it at the top of the disc, which is where the sight wire is pointing to. So we've taken a compass bearing from a map, and we've also taken in a compass bearing from a ground feature, you know, by sighting it. So now we want to follow that bearing. Let's say that when we took our bearing, you know, when we sighted our bearing and also when we took it from the map, the bearing that we want to follow is 1, 2, 3. So all you do is you turn the compass until 1, 2, 3 degrees is directly below the sighting wire. So the sighting wire is pointing directly at 1, 2, 3. Then rotate the dial with the glass in it until the long yellow line is directly above the north arrow on the disc. Okay. Now, that way it just makes it easier. If you want to check you're going in the right direction, you don't need to look at the quite small numbers on the disc. All you need to do is always ensure that the long yellow line is directly over the north arrow on the rotating disc. Okay. Now, all you'd then do is you would look for something along your bearing and walk to it. And then when you get to that, you look for something else that's along your bearing and you walk to that. And you keep on doing that, you know, sort of leapfrogging along until you reach your destination. Okay? So that's how you take a bearing, sighting it from a map, and it's also how you follow a bearing using these particular compasses. So now we're back to the two yellow lines. Now, we have a problem here in that I've just shown you the modern method of using these compasses. When used like this, the smaller line, it's never actually needed. In fact, it could be removed by the manufacturers. You know, it would make no difference to anybody using the compass. That is, assuming that the manufacturers actually know what the small yellow line is. I'm not quite sure. Anyway, why are there two yellow lines? Why are they different lengths and how were they used? Now, as I said, I've just shown you how to use one of these compasses, but that wasn't the way they were originally used. Now, don't forget, this is a cheap copy of the first version of the M1950 US military compass. Now, later versions had an index line and a tritium mark. But the first versions, as I said, of these M1950 still had some parts, like the glass with the yellow line, that was taken directly from the M1938 compass. And so this first compass, people were taught to use it in the same way as they'd always done all the way through the Second World War, using the M1938. And it's just the rain's getting heavier. Now, do you remember that I said that in the past the long yellow line was used in the same way as a direction arrow on a base plate compass? Now, as you know, a base plate compass, once you set the bearing, you know, you go in the direction indicated by the arrow. But on the M1938 compass, you followed the direction that was set by the long yellow line. I'll demonstrate how this was first used, but please don't start using your compass like this. I'm only showing you it for historical purposes. Is that a good way of putting it? So, from the 1930s to about the mid-1950s, people were taught this method. So, let's say that you want to go on your bearing of 1, 2, 3. You would point your compass north, so here I am, okay, and then you would rotate the glass until the long yellow line was directly over 1, 2, 3 degrees, like this, and that is the direction that you would follow. Okay, so don't forget, keep the compass north, pointing north, the whole compass, and then rotate the long yellow line on the disc, and then just follow the direction indicated by the long yellow line. So as we're following the long yellow line, let's say that we wanted to walk north, east, south or west. All we'd need to do was point the long yellow line so that it's at 0, 90, 180 or 270. Now, in this video we've been setting a bearing of 1, 2, 3, you know, from a ground feature or from a map. In the daylight, that's easy. You know, we just point the compass north, turn the dial and we follow it. But at night time, you know, in the dark, that would be really difficult. This is where the short yellow line comes in. Now, just one thing to note, I'll put this near the microphone. When you turn the dial, it clicks. Okay, and each click, it turns 3 degrees. So let's say that you're out at night and instead of going on a bearing of 1, 2, 3, let's say that you want to walk on a bearing of 1, 3, 2. So again, all you do is set your compass north, put the short line so it's pointing due south. Now, as the two yellow lines are 45 degrees apart, this means that your long yellow line is pointing at 135. Don't forget, the short yellow line is pointing at 180, They're 45 degrees apart, so the long yellow line is pointing at 135. So you just need to turn the dial one click, or 3 degrees, anti-clockwise, and that will set the long yellow line, which is what you're going to follow, onto your 132 bearing. If the short yellow line wasn't there, you'd have to maybe put the long yellow line onto, say, 90 degrees, and then you'd have to turn the dial for 14 clicks, you know, to get onto your 132 bearing. And that is what the short yellow line is for. I'll give you another example. Let's say that instead of walking on our bearing of 123, we want to walk on a bearing of, I don't know, 321. So all you do in that case is set the short yellow line, so it's pointing due north, so it's set at zero. Now don't forget, the two lines are 45 degrees apart, so all you need to do is rotate the glass two clicks, or 6 degrees, and now the long yellow line is on your bearing of 321. So you just follow away. So, oh, back in the day, there were no small calculators or mobile phones, obviously, so people were more used to doing maths in their head, you know, mental arithmetics, than some people are nowadays. And that's what the two yellow lines were used for. Adding that extra shorter yellow line reduced the number of clicks that you need to turn the dial to get onto a bearing. And the idea being that the smaller the number of clicks, not only was it faster, you're also less likely to make a mistake. And the rain is just starting again. Now, I am going to call this video the compass that nobody knows how to use, but it's now not correct, because, you know, it's not true anymore, because there is one more person that actually knows how to use this compass, and that's you. Thanks for watching.